Okay, this is the Conway Selectboard meeting for February 29th. We'll call the meeting to order. First item on the agenda is the minutes. However, we're going to table the minutes for the February 22nd meeting because they're not quite ready. Next thing on the agenda is meetings attended by Select Board members. Jim, anything?
No, not this week.
Yes, on Saturday, myself, Jack and Daniel Lockhead, Joe Strakowski, Sue Bridge, and of course Bryce is there, and a few other residents of Conway. I went to the Steve Kulik meeting on solar updates and the net metering discussions he had, which was very, very informed. I was at the meeting. Steve did a wonderful job, I thought. And
yes,
and it was probably about 75 to 100 people there attending it.
I would say you're pretty close to it.
Pretty close, he did a great job in the meeting, and it was very informative. I'm sure Bryce will comment on it later.
Okay, great. Thank you, Bob. Next item, citizens' concerns. Do we have any citizens' concerns? I don't see any citizens' concerns, so we'll go to the next item. Under old business, we have a town meeting warrants. Items so far, Tom?
Yes.
I am pleased
to present the draft. Anything in italics isn't going to happen yet. There's just a few towards the end. Of course, there's a big blank space. Everything in italics under the Article 2 is not set yet, especially what's recommended. Then I go in descending order of how much things cost. So we start off with the most expensive things first. And money items continue all the way through page 3. The community preservation fund I put down as a money item, but after the others because it has its own source of funding. And for non-money items, Parks and Rec is asking for the sports revolving account again.
What article is that?
18, top of page 4.
This is the same article they had in last year?
Yeah. And I don't know whether we're going to have a right to farm bylaw or not. I have a hunch we won't this year. There's a just a reference in our bylaws, in the protective bylaws, which needs to be changed. It's either an outdated or just a wrong reference. There's Article 21 proposes a bylaw that only Conway residents shall be allowed to serve as voting members of Conway committees, is what that should say.
It says committees in the online.
So that should be the Conway committees.
The elected members are now in the bylaws as having to be residents of Conway. This just makes it the same for, I'll say, boards, committees, and commissions, and that will cover the waterfront. I put on here again to see if the town will authorize the select board to close town roads in the case of dangerous driving conditions. This is something that Ron would find useful when they're working on a road in case of some sort of disaster.
Mm-hmm.
Just being able to say, don't drive on it, that would be very helpful. Article 23, I'm still waiting for final word from the Festival of the Hills folks. But the last I heard, they're still planning to go private. Mm-hmm. So we'll see if that moves forward. That should actually be in italics, too. I don't believe there will be a special housing article. I don't know if there's anything coming from the planning board for the protective bylaws.
Was that the dissolved Festival Hills? That wasn't submitted by the wastewater committee, was it?
Ah, that would be my template. No, it was not. Thank you. That's exactly the kind of eagle eye I depend on for getting this thing right. And neither is the senior housing committee. And
I was wondering.
Yeah. Thank you. And of course, the next one, PEG access, is not that either. There is a wastewater committee down there in 28. Article 26 is something new. It establishes a special revenue fund known as the PEG Access and Cable Related Fund. This is coming down to us from the Department of Revenue. They say you should pass this bylaw and you should have this fund, and this is where your PEG Access money should go.
We already have a line item, an account for that.
Yes, we do.
But do we ever have an item?
But we have not, as far as I can determine, accepted General Laws Chapter 44, Section 53F and 3/4.
Oh, okay.
That's allowing us to do what we
so
doing.
It's a...
So it's administrative.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then there's just a blank space for any other bylaw amendment that might happen to come along.
And that says wastewater as well.
The one below it, Article 28, was actually submitted by the Wastewater Committee.
All right, okay. Nice.
I put all these things up above it, and it kind of
felt it down
and moves. And we might want to move that up, just because it is just hearing the report. They might have some information that as many people should hear as possible at that. We'll hear more of them when that comes along. If I can go back to the money articles for just 1 second, I would have a broad overview. Article 3 is the pumper, waiting for the Capital Improvement Planning Committee to come in and talk more about that, how they want to do it. Last I heard, Dana Goodfield was looking at the possibility of using general stabilization funds as well as capital stabilization funds to avoid borrowing. But avoiding borrowing isn't necessarily the best thing to do. But more on that later. The three stabilization accounts, 4, 5, and 6, I think are all going to be recommended by the Capital Improvement Planning Committee. That's the last I heard. The 250th Anniversary Committee will be coming in either next week or I think actually on the 14th. But it may be next week. I'm going to have to check to see what that was. They've been asking for $10,000 a year for a long time.
Right.
Yes. And now they've planned a whole lot of stuff and just came in with a request for $30,000, which you'll notice that one thing that isn't on here, unfortunately, is Ron's request for the concrete pad and lifts. I'm anticipating that the Capital Improvement Planning Committee is not going to recommend that, at least for this year, though it's still kind of in play. If it did happen, it would be there. If we don't do that, we have enough money for this $30,000, but otherwise we don't.
Do we have, we've been giving the 250th Anniversary Committee money for four years now? Was it 3 years?
Seems
it was
like going to
be a five-year situation. So this year would have been the fourth year, next year the fifth year, because next year is the anniversary.
The problem with that is that what we're doing is we're setting up the fiscal year 17 budget, which ends at the end of June 2017, and I believe that they are planning their events for June 2017.
Right.
So it's within the 2017 budget. If we pass money,
okay, then
for
then
fiscal
this
year
is,
18,
this is the fifth.
This
year.
Will be the final budget.
Yeah.
Okay. Does Joyce have an accounting of?
She does, and I think the committee. I can speak to you, John, a little bit, because my wife's on the committee with a bunch of other people. And I think I heard rumors that they've got like 50 some odd thousand filled up in accounts right now. And they have with Joyce and them.
Okay.
And they just had an event on Saturday night, which was very small but very successful. And I rumors have it, I think they made around a little more of money on it. It was definitely not a loss. Attended by a bunch of, majority of attendance was by Conway senior people.
Mm-hmm. Do they have a budget for why they're asking?
I think they do.
And they will come in and explain that. Okay. Either, and again, I'm not sure whether it's in 1 or 2 weeks, but they're, pretty soon.
The budget this last year is the largest because they're trying to plan a parade.
Right. They want the Lummers?
And no, they do not.
They're very, very expensive.
Yeah. A lot of the high school bands and the bands that they want to have for the parades all charge to get come here because of the fact of busing.
Right, yeah.
And I know that there's negotiations going on with some of the schools. They should have lightened this a lot more. They're into the community. I only get little bits and pieces about everything they've been doing. And they've been working very hard. I know that. They meet very often.
Okay. Depending on the recommendation for the highway garage stabilization account, it might be a good thing to start putting all of the stabilization account items in a single article. That would probably assist in their passing. People could always pull something out if people agreed that it ought to be pulled out. But that's another way of looking at it.
A lot of towns do it that way.
For any feedback that anybody has about that, let me know. Mm-hmm. And of course, very easy to do that.
I felt that we did that originally so that we would definitely have an account set up for the town garage and other accounts like a fire truck purchase or something else down the road. Couldn't draw off that?
Oh, they would all be listed separately.
Oh, okay.
But it would be a single article.
Oh, okay.
Because we have general stabilization and ambulance stabilization down under 8 and 9. Mm-hmm. Operating expenses for the ambulance department I put as 15 because that's what we always give them. We make up the rest with the stabilization. The assessors are now asking for $10,000 instead of $7,500 for the triennial revaluation because last year's mechanism for funding was flawed and they need to ask for $10,000 this year. Right. They didn't have enough in their overlay account to cover that.
So how did they fund it?
Well, it hasn't been done yet.
Well, it hasn't been done.
They set it aside every year, so. Then again, I'm asking for $10,000 for a conceptual design for converting the upstairs of the town hall into office space, and which would include, but just to make it clear, and to include a construction cost estimate and bid-ready plans. So what this would do is it would tell us how much money it would take to do the project, and it could be more or it could be less, depending on a number of factors. But it would be nice to know whether it was a really big project that we shouldn't bother with for a while, or whether it could be done for several hundred thousand dollars. The most expensive item is going to be the lift. But it can be a lift. It doesn't have to be an elevator.
Mm-hmm.
So finding out, again, working with somebody to do those cost estimates, come up with plans, that would allow us to decide whether or not to move forward with it. And I know that the chairs of our Conservation Commission and Planning Board are very anxious to have real office space, which in the way that I've been thinking about it, they would. Then, as requested, I put on the $3,000 for the Visual Gov budget presentation program.
Right.
Someone from that group would be available to come to town meeting and give a walkthrough of what that's like.
Yeah. Okay.
For the first time, Articles 14 and 15, the Open Space Committee and Ag Commission are asking for budgets. So the way that worked in Northfield was the first time a committee asked for a budget, it went before the town.
Mm-hmm.
And if the town approved the budget, then it became a line item.
Mm-hmm.
And similar to the capital expenses, I'm considering having committees as a single line item so as not to have a separate article for each one. Again, people could pull items out of that if they wanted to or ask questions about any of it. But it's a relatively small amount.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that would probably be a good thing. And we need every year or two to get $200 into the flag fund due to the cost of the flags
mm-hmm.
going up okay. in the cemeteries.
Yeah.
Community preservation, I don't have anything yet, but that'll be pretty profound. So that's where it stands now. Any more typos or anything, please let me know.
Yeah. Okay, right.
John, Tom, do you think we could, just getting back to this, still making discussion at this point, getting back to the town office space upstairs.
Yeah.
Could that possibly be something that we could roll into the community preservation funds? Seeing this could be declared a historic building?
Well, they don't look at this as a historic building per se. They did say they might be able to swing doing the cupola because it had historical resonance with the old town hall. I will ask, the thing is, I don't think so, because that would be restoring it. And it didn't have office space. This is renovating it. This is actually changing it into something it wasn't. So I believe that was the reason that I was given before. Why, but I can make sure that's the case.
You're probably right.
All right, thanks, Tom. When is our final budget due?
The warrant closes March 11th. The budgets have been due for a long time, but the warrant closes then, and then it's just talking with the right. with the finance committee. So anyone who has any suggestions has to get them in by March 11th.
Right. Okay. Thanks.
And then they'll know the whole universe of things. And I actually owe the 250th an apology. I should have remembered that they always had an article. It's just not being a line item. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I didn't think of it originally and did not get them an email. I thought I had. So it came in late. The amount was still quite a surprise to me, though, I must say.
Yeah.
Well, they need to come in and explain that, I think.
Yeah.
But they do have a plan for that.
My next item is human resource discussion of study and recommendations.
For that...
You're talking about the Don Jacobs study?
Yeah. Yeah,
and I'd like to meet with the personnel committee on that, get some more recommendations from them.
The way they left it was that everything else was a policy decision for the board. Mm. That they approved of the process, and...
I want to make sure we're not shooting ourselves in the
foot. Yeah, I'd like to hear
what they've got to say too. And I will tell you that one of them, both of them are coming from very different points of view on this. Mm-hmm. One of them, more familiar with public systems, thinks that we should go to a grade and step system, a simple grade and step system. Mm-hmm. The argument against that from the other point of view is that that is automatically pushing your budget up. And there may be years where you can't afford to do that and you're stuck between a rock and a hard place. Mm-hmm. What this would do, and again, we don't, we can do this in partial steps. Just to remind you, this is the way things stand at the moment. And due to a happy miscalculation, the total for bringing everyone who is not being paid at least the minimum of the comparable towns that were studied is now $9,164. So it's down from over $12,000. So that's good. That would bring people up to the market minimum that mm-hmm. he was talking about.
Yeah.
And, you know, that could be done in 2 years as mm-hmm. well. That's an entirely reasonable option. What I would like is for the board to decide whether or not they think that's a good idea. Now, one of the members of the personnel committee does not think that's a good idea because it's giving people something for nothing. And if they're in the job, then that's what their market is.
One of the reasons why I want to discuss this in an executive session with the personnel committee.
I don't believe this is an executive session matter, but if we discuss it with a personnel committee, it will not happen this year, period, because it's very difficult to get them to
start. How about the 14th?
I can ask.
Let's invite them in.
Let's get them in on the 14th.
And again, because this isn't about any individual, public salaries are publicly discussed. It's one of the
Well, let's investigate the possibility of an executive session. I think there's room for that.
I will investigate.
Okay. Can I have one question, Tom, about this? This labor for $3,603 on your dollar increase market minimum. Is that all laborers, including all the transfer station attendants? Because I noticed you got transfer station attendant of $88. That means for one person? And I know we have more than one attendant.
That's per person.
That's per person.
No.
We have more than one attendant then.
Yes, we do. So that would be multiplied by three. The laborer is just one. It's not.
Is that highway labor? What is it? Who is that? Highway labor or who?
Yeah. And that's just one position.
That's part time one we have or what?
That's not an equipment operator.
How many do we have in transfer station? We have more than three.
We have four now, actually.
We have four.
Yeah. So
this is the part time highway laborer?
Full time.
So you want to bump one up, $3,000 more? Oh, that's for all of them.
There's a steep drop off from equipment operator to laborer. This would bring the laborer up a little bit.
The one labor position we have.
This is exactly why I want to discuss this with personnel.
Okay. I just want the clarification as to not who it was, but what positions we're talking about here. I get it.
And again, the way it was left was they decided that all of the data was correct and that any further decisions were policy decisions to be left to the select board.
So this $88 on transfer station attendant can't be right then, correct?
It's actually, we'll add $264, not time. Yeah. Well, that would be the total, but adding $264 to the bottom line there makes it...
$95.
But it's still saving almost $3,000 from the original.
Yeah, we need to discuss that. Eh?
Yeah.
Do you need a vote, John? On that?
No, we don't. We'll no.
Make a motion that we invite
them. We'll just table it until the 14th and ask them to come in.
Yeah.
Okay.
I will do my best.
Okay. All right. Anything else on that, Tom?
Not on that.
Okay. Policy on family members on the same committee. Okay.
Yeah, I sent this background piece out for different options. Mm-hmm. And I also sent it to council. Mm-hmm.
Did he have any strong recommendation on this?
No. What he said was that there's no legal... there's no legal argument to be made one way or the other, but that it could be seen as a conflict of interest or the appearance of impropriety for the reasons that I've laid out in this sheet, and thought that I had covered all of the points in this brief paper for your consideration.
Did Jack have a specific, did he see these choices?
Yes, he did not have a particular suggestion.
He had no suggestion for us.
Well, legally, there's no legal question. It's a policy question.
An old judge once told me that if there is even the appearance of, it shouldn't be.
Well, and that's why I would recommend the stronger end of the spectrum.
You're talking about four?
Yeah.
Strictly prohibit the practice.
You might want to leave some flexibility in three if there was some extraordinary circumstance, but it's a policy anyway, and it's the select board's policy. And if there were something, the reason to have the policy is to have something to deviate from if you need to. Mm-hmm. So if you have the policy that prohibits the practice, then you can always deviate from it if there's a strong enough argument in favor of this particular expertise or or something like that.
So three is the best option.
Three or four.
Well, you just argued against four.
No, if you take it as a policy that you strictly prohibit the practice, you're free to rework your own policy in an extraordinary circumstance.
But then
you
don't have to change the
policy. You don't have
policy.
To say that.
Right. Then we have to change it every time.
So you know you can say we can be flexible. That would I think result in people trying to make arguments as to why this was an extraordinary circumstance. Which, you know, it's a small town. You have trouble people getting on. You have trouble getting people on committees. That's why I thought three was an option. But yeah, either three or four, I would say, would be the way to go.
What do you think, Jim? Bob?
I'm kind of leaning a little more toward option three, practice in general, but allow exceptions under our extraordinary circumstances approved by the Board of Selectmen. Mm-hmm. Because some of these committees, you have hard times. They really don't deal with much financial of the community. Mm-hmm. But like, let's take like the Festival of the Hills Committee or the 250th Committee, where you have sometimes family members in there.
Yep.
And they're lucky to get the numbers up to be able to get their workforce.
Mm-hmm. Well, and one possibility is to have a small committee, but a larger group that doesn't have the official responsibility of being on the committee. That's one way to do it. Do you know how many members there are of the Festival of the Hills Committee now?
It's rising. I think there are probably 10 or so now.
Which means they have to have at least 5 for a quorum. And you know, they probably haven't had a problem with that, but that's a large committee.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's tough to get that many people on committee. What do you think, Jim?
Well, I like flexibility. But I guess when the situation arises, maybe it should be considered as needed, you know, and
so
depending on the circumstances.
You're talking about three, basically, right?
Yeah, that would be, well, that's twos, where I see allows flexibility for the appointing authority.
Three would allow flexibility, but under extraordinary circumstances.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That is, you know, if
three better, probably.
If there was a compelling reason, again, expertise or something like that. I know that, you know, it takes dozens of people to run the Festival of the Hills, and they're clearly not all on the committee.
Right.
So then the question is, what is the purpose of being on the committee? Well, it's the steering committee. It's the people who make the decisions.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's an argument for the more people there are making, the, you know, more minds are better. Of course, everybody's opinions can be shared, but it comes down to the number of people who are officially on the committee, mm-hmm. and what that means and why there should be more or fewer.
Okay. Jimmy, you like three?
Yeah, I like three.
And Bob, you like
three?
Yes,
I do.
All right. I'll make a motion that we accept number three as our policy to move forward.
A second.
All in favor?
Second.
Yes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'll try to come up with some, I'll try to flesh that out a little bit. And, you know, you can see whether or not you want something that says...
Yeah,
I think
three is fine.
Yeah, okay.
Next item is the Energy Committee update. Bryce?
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for your time. Quickly, I wanted to go address a letter that the Energy Committee had evaluated and agreed to forward to the Board of Selectmen to ask you to sign this and send this to our legislators, Stan Rosenberg and Robert DeLeo, as well as copies to various other members of the government. The focus, the target of this is regarding the reforms to solar policy and the elimination of net metering caps. As Bob said, Steve Kulik had an information session down in Sunderland on this weekend, and it was extremely well attended, and it was There's a lot of contributions from a lot of people in the audience, so it's a very understood issue that's going on. I think that you're also aware of it, that right now the legislature is debating regarding net metering, both the cap and as well as whether they're going to leave the rates at what it is, which is retail, or reduce them. And then as well, the solar renewable energy credit incentive program is about to expire. Mm-hmm. Nothing seems to be happening at this point in time, and it's putting a real damper on any further solar development, either commercial or residential, of which the town of Conway now has a dog in this fight, both with the Solarize Conway residential program. We're working with Colerain and Shelburne, as well as with the RFQ regarding the town solar farm. So basically, this letter is, we would like you to consider signing this, and basically to asking legislators to support eliminating the cap on net metering. Number two is maintaining a fair value for net metering credits, taking into account the project size and type with full rates for small projects. Mm-hmm. And lastly, to create a new solar incentive program to reach the solar goals after it reaches 1,600 megawatts. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And this was composed by the Energy Committee?
This actually came to us, and I'll be honest, is came to me from some committee, and I don't know, it was back in early January, and I don't recall who it was, but I basically redrafted the letter that they had suggested. Adding certain portions that are more respective to Conway.
Okay, and this was voted on by the Energy Committee,
yes,
and recommended to the,
yes,
board. Okay. Have you had a chance to review the, yes, the letter?
I did read it, yeah.
Okay. Okay. Any questions for Bryce? Okay. Yeah, I think it's a good letter, and I think this is something that's absolutely necessary. Certainly for Conway and our Solarize program.
Right.
Yeah, I'll make a motion that we, on the recommendation of the Energy Committee, we sign this letter to Robert DeLeo, the Speaker of the House, and Stanley Rosenberg, the Senate President. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you, Bryce.
Yep.
Thank the Energy,
yep,
Committee.
Well, thank you. Let me give you a quick update on where the Solar Committee is, the Energy Committee is right now. Is with the Solarize program we're doing in tandem with Shelburne and Colerain, we are just about completed the RFP for the solar installers, mm-hmm, which will be going out, which we're actually meeting Wednesday to finalize that, which will be going out. There's a letter, or actually what we will be doing for the contracts, is I think we'll be adapting what the town of Conway is using for the contracts and agreements. More on that later if you need to sign off on that. The solar farm has basically been out for RFQ, and the deadline for that is March 11th, and I believe we will have some more, we will have some bids to evaluate. The community preservation program, I think that's what it's called, right? Has been very successful this year, and I believe they're on the agenda for the 14th to present, as well as somebody from the Community Preservation Association, mm-hmm, organization will be here. Is that new to you, Tom?
Yep.
Let me just double check. That was what I was indicated. I think that that's what they're looking at. So if you might be able to pencil that in, I think Sue was confirming that with somebody from the Community Preservation, because they were coming up to make the presentation.
Not housing?
Hmm?
Not housing?
Sue's been pretty much running point on that, so I just thought I'd bring up what I thought was going on.
I have a notation here also for the 14th. The Board of Health. They're supposed to be to that meet with us on the 14th. I just jotted in. I don't remember now why I did that, but I wonder if they were meeting with us on the 14th too.
I don't know what that refers to.
Tell you what, let me get in touch with Sue and have her close the loop on that.
Good idea.
Okay.
Because she's been very eager and anxious to have somebody from the community preservation organization to come here to present to you. Because it's been a very successful program. I'd like to continue that along with the town's support as well.
Community action.
Is that what it is?
That's who Sue's been working with.
All right. Like I said, she's been running point on that.
Okay.
The Conway Town Hall, we're starting to move forward again regarding the energy retrofitting. I don't know if you're aware that the first time the bids came in, they were three times what the budget was.
Mm-hmm.
We've been working over that and trying to come up with some other solutions. We think we have something that will work, that will work very well, that will meet our budget needs, and I believe that we're working, the engineer that we have on the job is working to develop the new bid specs on that. And the last thing is, they're on a, maybe it's on a far distant horizon, but we are having to start having discussions regarding a town microgrid. For distributed generation here in Conway, which is a very exciting prospect, but it's also very daunting when you consider the area that we encompass in the miles of power lines. But so this seems to be a movement that's gaining traction in a lot of communities to have basically you're on a microgrid. And so I'll let you know. So that's something looking forward to far down the line.
Okay.
Does that include the Conway Dam for water power?
That was something we discussed. That dam and or one of the ones on the Deerfield. I think the number two is not being used, yeah. Which would probably be a better bet.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, is something we
tried. Number two is being used, but it's under renovation.
Oh, it is? Okay.
Yeah, they're working on it.
All right. So we're sort of looking at what options there are. But that's something that'll take quite some time.
The RFP for the solar installer for Solarize.
Yes.
How are we distributing that? Is that going out? Is that going out to the central register? Do you know?
I'll check. We're meeting on Wednesday to finalize it. I'll ask them how that's being distributed. I think it'll probably be going out perhaps that way, but as well as through the Mass Clean Energy Center.
Okay.
To their known group of installers.
Okay. Great.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you, Bryce.
Thank you very much, everybody.
My next item on the agenda is the proposal to meet with the school committee and the superintendent. Tom?
The general question is valid, and that is, would the select board the finance committee ultimately be willing to meet with the superintendent at a school committee meeting where the superintendent proposes the budget, so that the superintendent and the business manager didn't have to present the same information twice.
Okay.
That way the school committee, the finance committee, and select board would all be meeting with the superintendent and the business manager.
Do we have any proposed dates for that?
The one proposed date was quickly withdrawn due to conflicts within the school committee. So we are waiting for another date. But if it sounds, you know, generally possible, then that would be helpful. I would.
Sure. If it streamlines the process for them,
yes.
That's fine. Sure.
Yeah. Okay, that's great.
Right, anything else on that, Tom?
Nothing else on that. No.
Okay. Community compact. Long-range planning and IT best practices.
I have finally gotten some good, a good direction. This is something that Joe Markarian put together for the COD. He's doing the same thing in many towns under the community compact, and finance committee should also get.
Okay, thank you.
And I have spoken with Joe about this, Jim, I'm sorry. And he's been initially in favor of it, and Dana Goodfield is also in favor of it for capital improvement planning. This would happen sometime in the fall, I hope September, I hope early in the fall. And the two parts of it, one is the long-range financial planning, and this document explains what that would be about. The second part of it is best practices for municipal information technology. Mm-hmm. And that is also something that Joe's working with Todd on. And we would still be able to work with our own IT guy and who would coordinate other work that the COG is doing to try to compile, first of all, what best practices are for municipalities.
Yeah.
And also to implement them. So this is the long-range planning part of it. The other is the IT. With these pieces in place, I feel ready to submit a community compact.
Okay. Yeah. Let's move forward with that. Yeah, Joe does some good work for the COG. All right, next item on the agenda is the letter to the governor regarding the Massachusetts Broadband Institute's work on internet access to the town.
When the current Massachusetts Broadband Institute director resigned, the last thing he said before he resigned was that the department...
Who just resigned?
Eric Nakajima.
He resigned?
Yeah.
Really? When was that?
A couple of weeks ago.
Really?
Or a week and a half ago. He's been running for state rep in Ellen Story's district.
And that's the reason he resigned?
Yes.
Okay. So obviously they don't have a new executive director yet.
Right. And this is to let them know, and a number of letters have already gone out from partially cabled towns saying, we understand your need to assess things, but we also don't want this process to be stalled indefinitely. Mm-hmm. Please move forward as expeditiously as possible because we've been waiting for a long time and we're almost there. Comcast has already agreed to a lot of plans that would be really great for the towns. Mm-hmm. So this is a letter that is the same as the one that Buckland sent, Huntington sent one, Northfield sent one, another town has also sent one. So it would be great if Conway would send one as well.
Okay. Have you guys seen this letter?
Yes. Yeah, I did. Yeah, what was sent out was the one that Buckland sent out, but this is the same. I added one comma. Mm-hmm. For clarity.
Okay. Okay.
For clarity.
So it's officially our letter.
Yeah. Okay. We'll be able to tell it apart from all the other letters.
Okay. All right. I think this is a good letter. And certainly we need to keep this process moving for those houses in town, those properties in town that don't have high-speed cable.
Yep.
That's very important. I'll make a motion that we sign this letter to the governor.
Second.
Yep. All in favor?
Aye.
Next item on the agenda, the Finance Committee. Just came in time.
Great.
All right, we're gonna go over some town budgets. The first one is the Highway Department.
And I have extra copies of all these. Affects the town administrator's budget, and that is that I would like to reorganize the building maintenance function in the town. Right now, I'm responsible for building maintenance, and there are a number of reasons why that is not the best fit. One of them being that I don't know anything about building maintenance. I've been keeping things going and processing the invoices and all that sort of thing. In the past, this has been something that has sometimes been done by the Highway Department, and Ron has agreed that for a very similar terms that the immediately former Highway Superintendent had agreed to, he would take over that function. One of the things that I would also like to do is give him some extra clerical time. So this budget includes 8 hours rather than the historic 5 hours for the highway clerk. This includes extra hours for the building maintenance function. A lot of the actual administration of building maintenance is processing invoices, scheduling appointments, things of a clerical nature. And whereas the highway superintendent would be the supervisor, what I am proposing is that there be extra clerical time to take care of the actual work that needs to be done. Currently, Liz is working 3.5 hours for the highway department, as that's her maximum limit without being a benefited position at this time. And I would, at the same time, like to expand her hours in the town administrator office to 19.5. And she can tell you in her own words about all of the things that she's having to do right this very week, if you would like to hear those. So the highway and budget in under hourly wages goes up about $6,000. Also, I have put in under highway salary on the top line an increase which reflects the amount that, again, has historically been the amount the highway department supervisor has gotten for the job of supervising the task of building maintenance. So there are two lines here that are higher, two salary lines that are higher than last year. And that's the reason for that, is I'm trying to reorganize the building maintenance function.
Questions from finance?
And of course, Ron can walk you through the rest of the budget.
So the higher, so does that mean on another budget those numbers are lower?
Yes. I'm sorry?
You're saying you were just explaining why these, the two lines here are higher?
Yes.
So is there another spot in the budget here where those lines are lower?
No. Okay. This is additional work. Partly because I'm also asking for my assistant's hours to be increased up to 19.5 from 16, because there is sufficient work to cover that, those hours. Mm-hmm. So it's a complex switch, but that is what I'm requesting. Any part of it could be talked about and split out.
So this 8 hours weekly is for the hiring increase is a new person?
It would be a new hire, yes.
Oh, so you're going to keep Liz at
19.5 hours.
The max for the part, for whatever it's called, the benefit, the ceiling, yeah, for the benefits or whatever.
But bring her back.
But focus on, okay, so you're going to, basically the time she's putting into the highway now, she's going to give to you, and we're going to find someone else to do 8 hours a week or a month. What is it, 8 hours?
It's 8 hours a week.
8 hours a week for the highway.
Yes.
Okay. And that would be a new
hire. And that was, that had been 5 or 6 hours?
It was three. No,
I think it was 5.
5, I think, yeah. Well, yeah. 4 for highway, 1 for firewood.
Oh, all right, 4. The hours are of course, negotiable. That's what we figured out would help.
Okay, and the building maintenance budget, though, is actually a department number. It's
currently, I'm managing the building maintenance budget.
Right, but it's...
And that function would go over... And Ron would supervise that.
It's a totally different.
Yeah,
what is 192? Oh, here it is, 192, right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think you might have been wondering about that, Tom, right? Mm-hmm. There is a separate budget for building maintenance. that's rising like $1,100 mm-hmm. for
yeah.
some reason. But the time associated with building maintenance is going to be captured in the highway departments.
Yes, but it would become a highway department function.
Right, but we're still going to keep Department 192. We're not going to fold that into 422.
We could.
Well, I'm not saying that we should. I'm just trying to understand.
Yeah, I think there's a reason to keep it separate because it's a well-defined area of work.
Yeah. Yeah. I had discussions with Tom about this, and after being in a position for 20 years myself, I felt that it might be more beneficial for the community of Conway to advertise this position out to the open public to see if there was something like maybe some person out there that might be more carpentry-oriented that could take on the position of overseeing the buildings and maintenance of them. Because in the past, when we have a problem, if it's a minor problem, it's a door problem, a window problem, small things, we have to hire a carpenter. Whereas these small projects like that, this person could handle them themselves, plus through the administrative part of it.
Yeah,
I know Ron, I found it very difficult, and I was always assuming it, because I've had some carpentry background, but not a lot. And I found that very difficult, and I would very often discuss it with more carpentry-oriented people that I knew were in the trade in Conway. Now, maybe there's nobody out there that's interested, but I just felt that maybe we should explore that avenue. Mm-hmm. To see if it was available to somebody.
And I would expand it beyond just carpentry. I would say light repair a plus.
You know, that would save the town some money in the long run.
Well, it's building maintenance, facilities maintenance, or whatever we go by.
But can I just back up for a second? Again, a good portion of the position is being a clerk to the highway department. And what we're adding is the administrative duties that have to do with building maintenance as well. And along with that, it would be certainly be a plus if somebody had some light repair experience. And, you know, not limiting it to just carpentry, but...
So I'm sorry, I got to ask you to back up.
Yeah.
The clerical hours for both, for expanding the highway clerical mm-hmm. are because it is additional highway clerical work as well as building maintenance clerical work, facilities clerical work. Is that what I understand?
I'd like to ask Liz if you'd like to speak to highway clerical work.
Yes, sure. Right now I'm working 3.5 hours a week, which I'm finding after 25 years of administrative work at levels higher than this is not adequate at all. There's quite a bit of paperwork, I think, that needs to be managed, tracking of expenses by each piece of equipment and road inventories and just basical, and that's sort of project-oriented work, but even the basic clerical of checking, cross-checking the warrants. There's lots of invoices, I think, that a clerical person could be handling in a way and checking in with Ron. Getting back to residents, you know, helping Ron with that, replying to residents in a more timely fashion, you know, because his office is not near where the garage is, so it's difficult for him to come in regularly and stay on top of basic communication issues. So I think there's lots of room to go up from 3.5, but even if it were a couple more hours.
That's not what I was asking. I'm just trying to know where...
It's in that 8 hours, I think what you're asking, correct? That what? 8 hours is both combined.
Right. And is the 8 hours, where is it in these budgets?
That's under highway hourly wages.
So this is the clerical aspect of highway and facilities maintenance are in that.
Yes.
Right. Okay. And nothing related to this is in that other department here.
Nothing is in building maintenance.
That's all. I want to clarify.
Okay.
I wasn't questioning the need for
right. Well, it's good to hear it anyway.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we would be increasing her hours to do both and then hiring an 8-hour person to do the maintenance?
No. She would come as a full half-time person. in my department.
Okay.
And there would be a new person hired to do highway clerical, building maintenance clerical, and light repair would be a plus.
So if I could just, when did Laura stop doing the highway
clerical? When Ron took over.
Okay.
When I retired.
So was that when Liz came on?
She just came on recently.
No, so, okay.
There's sort of two positions. I just happened to be here, and it worked out well that I could take on this position. Both, for, you know, worked out for me, and it works out because I can, when needed, go back and forth between the two positions. Like today, something came up in one office while I was technically working in the other.
So what happened with Laura doing the highway clerical? Her time gets
She was not doing it for some time, and then Liz was able to step in.
Okay.
Ron opted not to have her do her clerical when he took over.
Right.
When I took over, it was more of a learning thing to know exactly what was going on, and I was having a little difficulty in the beginning having her time filled. Plus, it was an issue because at the time we were having trouble with computers and trying to do my job and her trying to work off the same computer was problematic. Now we kind of got that straightened out, so that's not an issue now.
If I may speak a little bit on the highway clerical, of all the years I was in as highway superintendent, year after year, progressively got more and more time spent in the office trying to do clerical work. Because as the community grows and things happen and budgets go up, Ron can attest to this, it takes more time to solve this stuff. Mm-hmm. And what it did to me, and I'm sure it's doing to Ron, is taken away critical time that he should be out there with his crews on the roads, mm-hmm. but he knows he's got to do that paperwork.
Oh, I'm convinced. Maybe some other folks are. Speak up if you have questions.
It's a very important part of his budget.
I agree. I think the things that Liz mentioned, inventories and customer service, tracking maintenance costs, I mean, those are, you know, I mean, that's important stuff, you know.
We'll help the finance committee and the capital planning committee.
Yeah, that's valuable.
Yeah.
Well, the state requires more and more paperwork too, doesn't it?
That's right.
As time goes on.
Yeah.
Track licenses.
Mm-hmm. So chapter 90, financial related stuff, yeah. So,
one question, if I might. I didn't realize with his highway uniforms. I see there's an item there.
It's not uniforms, it's clothing allowance. Each person gets a $500 allowance.
We used to have uniforms years ago.
Oh, okay.
The town approved uniforms.
I guess I forgot it.
And as the years grew on, it got more and more and more expensive to the point where it got hugely out of control because they were increasing their cost to us, the town economy. Yeah. So I met with our workforce, and we decided that the best way would be allow them so many dollars a year, they go out, buy whatever they need for uniforms, shoes, or whatever they need, they bring the superintendent back to check. We had areas, I had that set up with a store in Greenfield, or they could go. In the store agreement, they could charge to the town accountant's account if they went to that one store, up to a certain dollar amount per person. And if they didn't want to get it at that store, they could go anywhere and buy it on their own and bring the receipt back to the superintendent, and I would submit it for reimbursement up to their limit per year.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And they all seem very happy with it. I don't know how they are today, sure. Ron, but
that's fine.
Well, I know it can be rough on your clothes, so I can understand that.
Very rough.
It was just the uniform word that caught me.
Can we get back to the other topic, though? So you had expressed concern that this might not be a good, that might be better, the building maintenance oversight function might be better handled by...
more of a professional
someone,
type.
Like someone else. Where do you guys stand on that? I mean, is that something that we need to entertain, or is that maybe a second phase after we do this for a year?
It's just my thought. I mean,
Common advertising for the positions. And again, you know, light repair experience.
Okay, so you are going to advertise.
I think what Bob was asking, what he was suggesting was the person in charge, correct? Not the,
well, not the clerical person.
Ron's going to be the person in charge.
I know, but he's suggesting that we should.
No, I was suggesting the person that's in charge of the building maintenance. Also do the light maintenance to save the town money.
Right, but Ron is the supervisor of the whole department. So that person reports to Ron.
No. You're talking about a clerical resource, okay, on the one hand.
Yes.
And a building over maintenance oversight / DIY resource on the other hand.
It's a handyman. But the major need is for clerical work for the highway department and for building maintenance to switch it over.
Right.
The status quo would work now if there were just a clerical person there. But it would be a plus if that person were also able to
the clerical person?
Yeah.
My eyebrows aren't up because I can't see the two happening together. It's because I'm trying to understand still what the direction you're going. It seems like we're not on the same page.
Why not?
Okay.
The first idea was more clerical help for Ron.
Right.
Moving building maintenance over to his department.
Just simply moving the function from you to him.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. That in itself would not involve, handy person.
Right, but I think Bob is suggesting maybe down the road we want to look at that. If Ron starts to find that, like you did, that he's having to bring in
the
contractor for stuff that.
The majority of the work to be done is clerical in what I'm proposing. Which isn't to say that it wouldn't be useful to have somebody who could do that clerical work, but could also do light repair.
But I don't think that's what.
No, see, that's not
what
Larry's saying.
He was suggesting at all.
That's what I thought.
The major need, the reason I'm proposing this, is to move the function over to highway, which would all I do is clerical work for building maintenance. So that's my fundamental proposal. I don't see anything wrong with adding, some functionality to that. But that's what my proposal is.
Maybe your idea will get more developed another time around.
My thought wasn't necessarily his idea.
Okay? Yeah.
I thought the person who they hired to oversee building maintenance also could do some of the maintenance to save the town money.
Who are we hiring to oversee?
Have to be under the auspices of the highway department.
Exactly.
Because
that's the key
in
here.
Past years, history in the town of Conway, it used to be under the auspices of the select board's office. Mm-hmm. And it went back to the select board's office when Tom came in. That's what I was thinking. Tom absorbed them.
How long did you do building maintenance?
Probably 10 to 12 years.
So that's the sort of recent experience.
Right.
And
I remember meeting about town maintenance budget with you.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean, I think you've got an interesting idea about, if there's another way to tackle this thing, but maybe just for this cycle, what we're talking about.
I know how full Ron's hands are. His hands are pretty well tied up, I think. We run the maintenance.
Thinking of getting a whole separate person just to do town maintenance.
Right.
I'm not sure.
They may need a secretary to do their paperwork.
That's an additional proposal that I haven't figured out the costs for.
Right. But so let me just summarize it. So basically, the clerical work that Liz has been doing for Ron would now be done by a new clerical hire who will do that amount and more. And Liz will be spending the time in your department, in the select board department.
That's the way it falls out.
So it's a net increase of about 8 hours. Mm. A new person could do 8 hours a week, right? Part-time.
Yeah, the new person could. And, it's a little bit hard to estimate. And I might have it 6 to 8 something like that until it settles in. But, you know, I've been listening to the amount of organization that is possible and thinking how much that would benefit the town. So I'm thinking that a minimum of four, probably 5 hours in hiring is not too little. And I spend several hours a week on just on invoicing and organizing and scheduling and that sort of thing.
You've been spending it as well as Liz?
No, for building
the highway piece. I mean, he's been doing the building maintenance piece.
For the building maintenance piece. So that's why I was thinking eight. It's like, I was thinking it was 5 plus 3.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions on this budget? The rest of it.
I got one or two more, I guess. These questions are kind of directed to Ron. One, but you got an $18,261 increase in your salt budget. What's the reason for that, Ron?
Because 2 years ago, salt was $58 a ton. Last year, it jumped to $76 a ton, and wasn't allowed an increase on that last year, and now it's up to $79 a ton. And I can't foresee it going down, and that's what the increase for the salt is the pricing.
And of course, you do know that if it goes over, you can come back and ask the
financial. Yes, it went over last year.
So this is just the basic cost increase for the normal amount of salt you buy a year.
Say again?
Mm-hmm. This is just the added cost for the normal amount of salt you buy a year.
Yeah, correct.
Okay.
And that's the highest increase in the whole budget because the salt costs.
And do you have an article in here about I saw, did that get cut out, Tom, or is that in here under the highway department for hardpack, purchase of hardpack, or does that get removed?
It's out.
It's out there? Or is it gone?
No, it's not there.
Okay. No question about that.
No, that's included under materials, yeah.
In the regular Harry budget?
That's in here.
Yeah. That's the jump under highway materials. And again, this is the new categories. We have to include both the old and the new for another couple of years so you can see how the payments have gone. It's called highway materials. It used to be blacktop, but now it's all highway materials, and that's jumping almost 10,000.
The only reason I'm not picking on you now, Ron, by no means, is I know you know to be your business, but it appears that you're about the only department that's want a fairly substantial increase, and all the other departments in town this year have pretty much level funded. Do you think that highway materials increase could be written off under Chapter 90?
This is basically what the materials that are other than culvert pipes or things like that. Most of all this material is for our gravel roads.
But that can be written off under Chapter 90, couldn't it?
Hardpack?
Yes.
Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, hardpack gravel.
You have to do
road
a project.
Huh?
You have to do a project. You have to list the project to do to write it off.
You just can't write it off in the general gravel road maintenance upkeep? Because that's where we used to do it.
There's no such thing. You have to do it. Chapter 90 money is by project. Mm-hmm. There is no place where you can just get a chunk of money to do.
So this is not just for one project, this increase? This is for
No. This is to soften the blow for the people because of the gravel that we're using on the roads. It's so that we can, when we're done putting the new gravel down, we can put a cover of the hard pack over so that it softens the blow with the stones that are in the gravel.
Must flat tires.
This is to address the complaints about the...
Yes.
Okay.
The aggregate is too big.
I didn't understand that.
See, but the problem is,
too big in
I was not aware of that.
If we go smaller with the aggregate, we're going to be shooting ourselves in the foot down the road.
These are unfortunate things that I have to ask, being in positions like that, because we don't get to meet with the department heads at budget hearing times anymore. And I think that's not right.
Well,
isn't this a budget hearing?
I did present the budget and ask for any questions that anyone had that I would be happy to get back to people with.
I think questions should be addressed to the department heads. It's just me.
Okay, any other questions for Ron?
So, I mean, just the thing about the winter roads, you know, with the... Mm-hmm. I think the received wisdom is to leave the winter roads alone because we can raise the overage on the recap. And then if we... Right? Isn't that sort of the...
But don't you think you're shooting yourself in the foot by not keeping up with the times with it?
Well, I think the other...
I mean,
the catch is, though, that if you...
You've got to have some allowance that they're going to... It's a bad winter, and they're going to be going over anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so what if this year's not a good one, but not if...
Sure. This is a good winter.
Yeah, it's a good winter for the town.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no, if it was, say, it was a winter like last year, and we left the budget where it is, and now we're going to be $30,000 to $40,000 in the hole.
You know, there's something though. There's some, Andre, and, well, there's a formula for how much provision for going back.
There's also a formula for how much you're permitted to overspend it without adjusting it. The next, in other words, if you go over a certain
budget, what's and that? Then lower.
Is that what it is?
Yes. So once we go up, we can't raise it and then have an overage that year. Because basically what was happening when they enacted the law where you could overspend it without town meeting vote is people were lowering them so low.
Yes, they were.
And then there was a problem.
So it's the lowering it that's the issue, not the raising it.
Not the raising it. It's the lowering it and then saying that you overspent in that.
Okay. The only thing that there were the salt increase this year that could possibly be a possibility, but at the same token, we don't know what the weather is. We can't bank on the weather between now and the end of the winter months. Is if he had a surplus of salt, unused salt on hand, that he purchased it on this year, and that was added to the for the usage for next year, that he wouldn't have to have an increase, but you can't bank on that because you don't know what's what.
I try to make sure that I have a full shed at the end of my budget year. Mm-hmm. And that's last year that finance committee told me to put it back to where I needed it. And that's why we had such a large overage last year.
Oh, okay. The 138 last year, FY15 expended. Versus the 120 budget.
So what you're saying
is...
What you're saying is...
I got told to fill my shed and do what I need to do down here to have it ready for the following year.
Yeah.
So if he has a good... I presume that if he has a really good year this year with not a lot of salt this year, which it looks like he's going to, well, we can't bank it on yet, that surplus money left in there will probably go back to the general.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
But I do defend Ron on the fact that we need to increase the salt and sand a little bit every year because the costs do go up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this budget's been flat since, this goes back to 2013 here, pretty much. So.
And this year, even though we've had a slow year,
El Nino.
This last rainstorm, I'm going to be spending some money with materials to put the roads back.
Yeah. Oh, everywhere. Yeah. Everywhere with this rain.
But it will be affected in my winter budget. Yeah.
I noticed that the highway repairs or vehicle maintenance one is going down a little bit. Can you tell us how the maintenance strategy is working out with the getting the, I see a big yellow old Northampton City of truck on the town fleet now.
We were having so much trouble with the 07.
The electronics,
So we replaced that truck with that truck there. And so far, things are good. There's been a few repairs that we've had to do to it. I knew that when we bought it, I'm hoping that the way things are going, that we've gotten things kind of smoothed out now and things are going good. And so it's workable. So the trucks are workable as far as being repaired.
So is the strategy, Ron, to buy older vehicles now?
Well, at this point, from all the horror stories that I've been hearing from other towns, where they get a brand new truck and they can't use them.
Well, plus to a lot of some smaller towns that don't probably have the capability to work on all that with all the electronics.
Right, most towns can't.
Right.
You have to take it back.
So the strategy is to buy used?
Well, at the moment.
Right.
I mean, we're just trying to make things.
So then the vehicle maintenance goes from 60 to 50.
Yeah,
I'm sure. We're using used vehicles. So I just was curious.
Well, here's the other thing.
The new ones that require the repair.
Huh?
It's the new ones that have been requiring the repair.
Well, if they're new, there's a warranty.
To answer that a little better, though, our equipment end of it is new.
Yeah.
The only thing that we don't have real recent is the grader.
But that has very low hours. There's not many hours on that rascal.
6,000 hours. 6,000 rough hours.
Yeah, since.
So, I mean, it would be a thing to be looking forward to, you know, coming down the road, you know, as far as replacing it. But my point is, with the new equipment, the maintenance part of it is minimal. And I don't know.
You're talking, when you say equipment, you mean like the yellow ones?
The
grader, the loaders.
Yeah,
the,
all that stuff.
The, right. Skid steer,
excavator.
One of the trucks is yellow too, but
that'll
be red.
There's trucks,
right?
And then there's equipment. The equipment is, like I said, the only thing that's not recent is the grader. And my plan is a 5-year plan of replacing so that we don't get into an issue with large dollar amounts on repairs. And that's where that's some of the reason why.
For the equipment repairs.
But, yes.
Yeah. But you mentioned, so there was a truck where you traded a new for an older.
Yes.
And was that an even trade, or was there?
It was.
Really?
But wasn't the new one, like Tom was saying, wouldn't it have warranties on it, or was covered?
It was an 07.
It was an 07.
So the warranties are gone?
You couldn't get money for the 07.
What's that?
You couldn't get money.
Well, the thing is that it had a lot of issues. You know, the rear body was in need of being replaced. I mean, it was rotted and dented and things like that. And I mean, we just, on our 04 truck, which now is our newest one, just came back today with a brand new body on it. And that's $40,000 just for the rear belly.
Is that one of those stainless ones that we voted at last town meeting?
Yep, last town meeting.
All right.
Yep, just came back today. So, I mean, personally, I feel very comfortable with our fleet, and I'm confident that I'm also trying to, you know, keep my budget within range and I'm comfortable with lowering at 10,000. I'm not going to guarantee that I stay within that, but.
I'll tell you what would be nice. We ought to just see what the ratio of the total roads and winter and labor is to the whole budget and see how that's changed over the past 5 or 6 years. I don't know if anybody has a handle on that.
I didn't understand what you asked.
Well, what the percentage of the whole budget pie devoted to roads and winter roads it has been for the past, I don't know, 10 years. It would be nice to see if it's stayed the same more or less, or if it's gone up or if it's gone down. So.
Well, it might be a little difficult because it didn't, salaries used to be come out of winter roads years ago.
So it might be it's a job to do it because, right. But it might be worth a while to do it. It's just because the roads are one of the significant outlets for the town.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Oh, yeah. We got a lot of roads in this town.
Yeah.
Compared to some of our neighboring towns.
It's a big expense.
Right.
It's a needed expense.
Right. No, listen, nobody's questioning that. It would be interesting to see if we could see a trend. Maybe it's going down. Maybe we're spending. Maybe we think we're spending more, but maybe we're spending less as a proportion to the whole town budget.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Any other questions for Ron?
Yeah. Are there any special spending articles from Highway this year?
Well, I submitted one, but I don't think it's going anywhere.
Ron submitted a capital request for a concrete pad with lifts to be able to work on trucks without lying on the ground and get them up a little bit. It would be a safer, cleaner work environment, and not having a garage with a maintenance bay.
Which is 8 to 12 years, probably.
Eight to 12 years?
That's my estimate.
How far away it is?
To get a garage.
Yeah. Okay.
At this point.
So this, you drive the truck up on it? Is that?
No, they're wheel lifts. There's four units. They grab each wheel and they raise the truck up.
So there's going to be some facilities work. I mean, you'd have to. This would be
outside.
Oh, this would be an outdoor thing.
Oh, really? Yeah, because, well, for one, we don't have the height.
What's the dollar amount?
What was that?
$50,000.
Yeah.
It just would be a much safer, better working environment for doing stuff, working on the equipment. I mean, you've got to lift the loaders, you could probably lift most all our equipment.
Right, but then that remove some of the justification for the new highway garage.
It'd be very useful in the new garage.
Sorry?
Oh, you can move it to the new garage.
Oh, okay.
I was going to suggest that if that moved forward, and I guess it hasn't, that instead of doing that, to take that extra $50,000, put it toward the highway garage for a quicker response to get the building built.
Are those, what do you call them, lifts?
Yeah.
Is there a long shelf life, a long lifespan to them, or are they... Is it throwaway stuff or is
No.
You've probably seen them before and didn't know you had.
Probably.
But if it's outdoors as opposed to being...
They're just little wheel lifts that you run up to the wheel.
Oh, okay.
But they're heavy duty.
So it clamps on the wheel and lifts it up? Is that it?
It's not a fixed device.
Okay.
All right. Other questions? All right. Thank you, Ron.
Thank you.
Tom? You got your budget.
The top line, the salary, that's in my contract. Whatever you guys give as a raise, I negotiate in my contract, and that's, so this reflects the actual number that was in that. Under hourly, the 15,543 reflects the extra 3.5 hours of clerical work that I would be getting with the building maintenance switch. Mileage will be going up. I'll still be adding some of my own money into that, but it would be a help. I go to meetings of the Small Town Administrators of Massachusetts, the Massachusetts Municipal Managers Association, and occasional other trainings, personnel and the Mass Municipal Association conference once a year, that sort of thing. So that's still not a full budget, but I don't want to bring it up too quickly there. Partly because I am bringing dues and conferences up substantially. I have been elected to the board of directors of the Massachusetts Municipal Managers Association, and so will attend their meetings more frequently, and they charge $40 a pop for those. That would also help with the Mass Municipal Association conference in the winter. The telephone is going up because I radically under-budgeted this year. The $2,500 was not a real figure and never was, and I have no idea why I let it be so low. I think we might have been hoping for some savings that we didn't get. Also, we've added a fax line. We have a voice over internet phone system in town, and faxes, I guess, now, after the fact, they let us know that faxes don't do well on VoIP lines. So I added a, you know, it's $30 a month or something like that for a fax line, Verizon standard thing, same number. That's why that one's up. Now, I have the internet going down from 4,000 to 2,000. That should actually be zeroed out. I have a $3,000 warrant item separately. We'll get a presentation by some people who put up a web-based budget tool. And this will be for the purposes of budget transparency. People in town can zoom in various parts of the budget and see where the town is spending their money. It's a big thing. It's very slick, this visual.
I'm sorry, you're talking about this eliminating the internet fee, but now you're talking about this other feature or something?
This is mislabeled, this account. Town admin internet, is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
So it's really town admin, it's part of the website for the town.
Well, it's IT.
It's not, but it's not internet access.
In general. No, that's all now in the new 159, which is coming next. So that 2,000 should be zero. There's going to be a warrant article. It's a thing. People might like it. They might not. It's in the interest of financial transparency. I'll just leave it at that for now.
So what was the expense here?
The bottom line should be 88,763. Oh, that was our entire budget. All internet. Mm-hmm.
All IT.
All IT. Well, computers and printers and such were dealt with under supplies. Again, I really under budgeted for that this year, but not too much if you take out the computers and things. So I'm only asking for $3,000 for supplies, but that's we were just treating computers as office equipment and putting it under supplies. That's the relationship between the internet and the supplies. And supplies is going up a little bit because even though we don't need $5,820, we do need $3,000. This repair and tech service, I'm leaving the same for the moment. It might be able to come down because I do also have computer tech service under the new IT line item. But we do have other repairs and technical services we have to do. I test the water, just odd things, but they can add up. So we have other than IT technical stuff we have done. I would look for that to come down because some of that was in IT in the past. But I would prefer to wait a year and see what it's like with the IT completely out of it before bringing it down. Town report, the actual last year was $3,750. We're looking into different formats. It was a pretty thick little booklet last time, so we're looking into an 8.5 by 11 format, moving to that, which a number of the towns around here have done. It could end up being per page more expensive. I think it would be easier to handle and read and work with.
Easier to pull the staples out of?
Well,
Rick and I went to a meeting, I forgot where, it seems like it was up in Huntington,
and they had a town report. We may have brought one back, I'm not sure.
They wanted
that was a larger format, and it was extremely nice, easy to read, not so thick, and I was impressed with it. Mm-hmm. Very nice.
We're also adding to look to, we're looking to add some pages, specifically minutes from the town meetings, which have not been in for a while, maybe forever, I'm not sure, but anyway, that's the actual cost for last year. So we'll be able to do it for that. The question is, what will the format be like? So we're working on that now. Let me go over the next thing, and we can cover questions about both of them together, unless you want to stop here for a second. The next one is the IT budget, which is proposed new this year. And the Honorable Mr. Cohen would like to recuse himself for the from the Finance Committee for a side
of it.
Sit over here, because you're not able to answer any technical questions. I will say that one of the things that was evident when I came to town was that the IT system was so basic as to be a little bit scary. We had a system where we just had basically a network router with everybody plugged into it, being able to share things and all of that, which is not very secure. You may have heard the horror story about the town of Orange or the town of Shutesbury, both of which suffered hacking attacks within the last couple of years. And with some money that was allocated by town meeting, I've gone ahead and gotten a server and off-site cloud storage and backups. We're in the process of making the server more secure and getting everybody on the same system. There are further upgrades to be done to bring it into modern compliance. And one of the items that I covered just before some people came in is that I'll be applying for the community compact status for Conway with two items. One of them is long-term financial planning. And since, I gave you the copies of that.
We have it.
So that's one of the things that I'd like the COGS help on, and Joe Markarian, a former DOR employee, is just extraordinary and has said that he'll be willing to help us with that in the early fall. And the other is IT best practices. And we've been talking with the Regional Council of Governments that actually Joe's also working on that project with them. And compiling a list of municipal IT best practices. Some of the needs are a little bit different. The need to maintain records for 7 years causes some data storage problems and things like that. So what we've come up with is four categories of expense related to IT. Obviously, $20,000 is a lot more than $4,000, but we are getting a lot for that money. There is a schedule behind the equipment and supplies, which involves changing out two of the town's roughly 14 workstations each year, as well as associated equipment. And the software and subscriptions is a real figure based on software that especially the treasurer uses, and other people in town have dedicated programs. And that is where the our internet service provider subscription costs are as well, under that figure. The maintenance has to do with monthly reports, monthly monitoring, really monitoring on an ongoing basis, but certainly monthly reports that show how the system's doing, and on a variety of levels, which I don't understand, and he would be the person to ask about why that is there and why that is the cost. And professional technical expenses are for things that, based on current consulting fees and the amount of time which has been observed necessary to spend on troubleshooting, we could expect to pay for ongoing troubleshooting. So it's different from the maintenance. I think that's the major clarification to make there. Maintenance is monitoring and addressing systemic problems that come up through the monitoring. The professional technical expenses is, my computer froze, I don't know what to do. I need it fixed because I have to give something to the select board in half an hour, you know, sort of thing. So that's the sort of on-call basis for it, split out by hours. All of these were calculated based on real expenses by Roy, who is our IT consultant. He has signed a disclosure form for conflict of interest, so, and the select board has agreed to approve that form. So that's my explanation of what this is all about. Some of you may have much more detailed questions, which maybe Roy can help with. So either town administrator or IT questions?
My first question is, what is happening with the website? Weren't we going to get a new website at some point?
That has been on the back burner as we address more fundamental IT issues. We do have the possibility of moving to another web host. Right now we're using a DreamHost program, which is adequate for most things that the town wants to do. A lot of towns and cities went to something called virtual towns and cities. You'll notice that a lot of towns' websites have the same look and feel. Greenfield, Montague are a couple of them. I don't know about Buckland, but I wouldn't be surprised. The feedback that I've been getting is that the price for that system and its ongoing maintenance seems not to be worth it. The longer you have it, the more you wish you weren't paying them as much money as they're charging you to maintain it.
All right. So the short answer is, so the website's on the back burner until we address
welcome.
Other
we got suggestions are welcome.
We got the fiber line that ran down 116, and we need to take advantage of that, right? And modernize. Is that basically the driving? I mean, other than the fact that you came here and found that it was like a switchboard from the 60s or something. I mean,
yeah.
I can't believe it was that bad. I mean,
there's a lot more we
between
can
Paul
do.
And with, Roy. I mean,
with the website, Liz is currently managing the content on that, and there is a lot of content to manage on the website.
Oh, yes, that's a lot of data.
We're constantly finding things that need updating, and it is especially at budget season not our highest priority. But we are aware of a number of, starting just with the content issues, let alone the format, but making sure that all the information is up to date. There are pockets that are not. And we always appreciate hearing about them, and we do take care of them when we can. But as in terms of an overall migration to a different system entirely, we're not at that stage yet.
Okay, thanks.
The IT support here that you're asking for, does that cover all the permits?
Yes.
Okay, and then you've got software and subscriptions for $3,900.
Yeah.
That does not cover all the permits.
It may be that...
Because the only reason I ask that is I haven't noticed in the assessor's budget.
Oh, they have a very special system.
That's a separate
yeah.
budget.
Yeah. That's a...
I know it's a separate budget, but I just...
These are... Yeah. They have a very special
system. I mean, system. We all have... Well, the police have it, a separate one.
Well, that's a state computer, and that's managed by the state mm-hmm. and maintained by the state.
Well, we have,
the town clerk also has a state computer yeah. that's managed and run by
the
state.
Well, I have a... computer program that I have to maintain the fire department.
Oh yeah. Well, if you want to shove it into this budget,
well, I know it's built into my higher budget. That's why I wanted it. I just wondered, you know, if this is going to cover a bunch of different departments, I got to quite understand why it and isn't all rolled into one.
It would be my fondest hope that at some point it will be. Right now, we're building the infrastructure. To hold things, once we can do that,
it I don't be think we're getting duplicate because every one of them is so damn expensive on each permit. Mm-hmm. So I just wondered if it would be beneficial down the road if it all ended up in one line item. You know what I mean?
I think you have an excellent idea.
So it's not all the systems. It's not the police. It's not.
It's
yours.
Everybody's computer. But some people have dedicated. Specialized software for their function.
Yeah.
And two people have dedicated computers for their function.
Right.
The assessors, for instance, run a GIS function, mm-hmm. and that's managed by a company in New Hampshire. Yep. So it is a complex bunch of systems, but all of the computers and their operating systems are managed as a whole.
This is the general stuff in this budget. The specific stuff for like assessment and
general,
clerk.
Not all inclusive.
Exactly, yes. That's under their own budgets.
So this,
and again, this is the first time that this has been put together in this way. Anyway, so it would be great if things got more. comprehensive and integrated.
Any other questions for Tom?
Yeah, the technical expense, is that like the $7,000, is that a retainer, or is that a guess on how many times the person's gonna,
that's
how
guess.
It is?
Yes.
It's a guess on?
Yeah, hours and grids of day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is every year?
This is an annual. This would be an annual budget.
Year.
Yeah.
Is that put out for a budget? Is that put out for a bid? Or how does that put out? Come on.
This was originally. How did we originally do it? Yes, I originally put together a request for proposals, and I shopped it around, and I gave it to at least one other person, and it was certainly available. I can't remember the specifics at this point, but it was there. The original was competitively bid. Yeah.
Well, I don't know if you want any comment, but I'll make a couple. So keep in mind that line for equipment and supplies. Those are to replace. You said two. I think it was three workstations a year.
Oh, okay.
Correct. Sorry. So that's given an assumed lifespan of 3 years. On these workstations, which is about what you sort of shoot for these days. They may not be broken down, but by the time 3 years goes by, things have moved along, and if you want to keep your staff productive, you want them to have the best tools that they can have. Mm-hmm. By the same token, I think if you add up the total, the approximate budget here, and you looked at it spread over the number of employees that are impacted and affected by it, and you also look at it over the budget, for example, the revenues that are controlled by those folks, it's a relatively it's not an insignificant expense, but it's, I'd venture to say it's on the low end of expenditures of any kind of ongoing concerns.
Yeah.
When I first came here, you know, it was kind of an afterthought. And now we have data protection in mind, we have compliance in mind, we have all the things that can really trip up an organization if they go wrong. So we try and be as proactive as possible with it.
Okay. Quick question. So at one point there was some, a couple of different camps about whether we needed a bunch of hardware in a closet here versus whether we could source our computing on the cloud. Which camp are we in now?
The solution that we arrived at, nobody would call it a, first of all, in the field of IT, nothing is permanent and nothing is a final sort of, you know, this is it. The costs to secure the overall system and to move towards compliance were and are relatively small compared to the major change in the way of work that would occur should we move everything to the cloud at one shot. So the thinking was to have the outlay. It was a few thousand dollars. Again, not insignificant, but it's not not totally significant in the overall scheme of things, so that we can have the security and have the peace of mind that comes with, for example, not having critical pieces of data on individual workstations. So not only are they on a central server these days, there's actually a copy of them on the server, there's a copy of them external to the server on the premises, and then there's a copy that is in the cloud. So we have what I call triple protection for critical data. And down the road we may totally move to the cloud, but honestly, some of the hardware has become so inexpensive anyway that it's not like, you know, it's not totally compelling to push it into the cloud at this point.
Thank you. And then the other question was, at some point, the folks who worked here couldn't communicate with the folks who worked in the town office, and there was like some dodgy connection. Has that all been sorted out now?
Yeah, they have. Part of this was a true firewall put into the system. The firewall enables actually an unlimited number of VPNs. So it's letting us do a whole bunch of different things that we couldn't do before.
What's a VPN?
Virtual Private Network.
Yeah, including that communication between
the buildings. Okay. Yes.
So Roy, do you see that down the road it could be like Ronnie's saying, will it make more sense to buy used computers?
Never.
I didn't say anything about buying used computers. I was saying buying things without computers.
Yeah. No, we're buying used instead of new. Makes more sense.
Yeah.
I have a question about the town report. That is for printing and sending it around?
I think it's just for print. That's just for printing.
And now this is going to probably sound stupid, and you guys can laugh at me. How come it's just not on the website and people need print it out if they want it? Why do we have to send it out to everybody?
Some of us in town do not have
decent internet. But they can go to the library or, yes, you know.
It's in the bylaw.
Oh, it's in the bylaw.
It is.
Okay. Sorry.
It could be removed.
It could.
I'm just thinking it's the modern world that I have.
We took a vote at town meeting. People wanted it mailed around.
Because I'm at the opposite point. I'm tired of mail. I'm trying to get as little mail as possible.
Well, not everybody has
a trash barrel right at the mailbox.
I wish we didn't have to mail it to.
Okay. I just had to ask.
Okay. Thank you, Tom and
Roy. I'll take my hat off.
Okay. Roy, do you have any questions about either of these budgets?
Do I?
Yeah, you are town administrator.
I don't.
Okay, thanks, Roy. Tom, anything non-anticipated in 48 hours?
So that's it for the finance committee section?
Yeah.
That's it? All right.
Yeah.
Excellent.
You can stay for the rest of the meeting if you want.
No, I think we might...
if you could let me know...
We're going to work on Article 2 recommendations a little bit.
Yeah, that's great. And if you can let me know other departments you might want to hear from, I can start setting up appointments.
Yeah, I think that's what we're going to... We're going to look through Article 2 hopefully in the next half hour or...
and one more thing. We had been asked by the superintendent if the select board and the finance committee can meet with the school committee when the superintendent and the business manager are presenting the budgets so that everybody hears all the information at the same time. It makes for a really large meeting, but it does make for potentially efficient information.
More clarity.
Yeah.
What we used to do.
We don't have a date at this point.
But we've always done that. I think we all get together and hear.
This is not with the school committee. This was the superintendent with the select board and the finance committee. After the school committee meeting. Now we want to do it all at one time.
Oh, all at one shot.
Yeah.
So it's safe
for the grammar school. So there'll be one hearing. Yeah. That's fine. I used to try to go to the grammar school's hearing anyway, so...
Yeah. And I'm not sure what the plan would be for the Frontier. That might be a separate meeting.
Right. But this will be the meeting. The school committee hears the budget, and then they actually vote on it.
We don't know what the details are yet.
Right. They just want it all at one time. They would normally vote on it at the conclusion of that meeting.
Yeah, I think that's... And we don't... But we don't know when that's going to be yet.
We don't. We had a date, but it was scrapped.
I mean, we can play it by ear, but that's a pretty big piece of the budget, so we're going to do that.
Yeah.
Okay. So thank you. Just let us know what.
Yes.
Tom, I think now it's just 40
minutes. Can I cross the street?
It was incredibly small, and
there wasn't
anything. Wasn't anything major.
Good. Concerns of the selectmen?
So.
Any concerns?
Tom and I have been discussing about the maintenance on the cupola at the top of the stone. Uh-huh. And last year, talked to Tim Morgan, who's a carpenter in town, at looking at this and give us an idea what it costs to repair if it needs any repair and repaint, because the paint's all falling off, as you noticed.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And there has been a couple pieces of wood that have come off it because they're falling on the ground. Small pieces.
Yeah.
So I was in communication today with him because we were trying to present and think about presenting an article to the CPA fund on town meeting for the work on it.
Mm-hmm.
But Tim has backed away from it because he said, you know, Bob, in the last year or so, I'm getting older and I'm really concerned about being up on the roof of the structure that high. So he said I would respectfully ask to be not considered it or even give me a price on it. And I asked him if he could give me a recommendation as to who maybe we could get some prices from. And at the present time, he said he would think about it, but he doesn't know. So I think that... whether we postpone this and let the new building maintenance people look at it, or we try to, sometime in the next couple of weeks, explore some areas for something. If we don't get it on the town meeting this time around, we need to have to go to a special town meeting or wait a year.
Mm-hmm.
Have to work on it. Mm-hmm. I think that the CPA fund people tended to be in favor of it, doing the work on it.
Mm-hmm.
It would fall into one of their categories. So I guess my question to you, the select board here, is what's your feelings on that as to what we should do next?
Turn it over to Tom. He's been handling
it. Yeah, Tom is in charge.
I'll just hire a crane and get it to put the thing down on the ground. If it's got to be de-leaded, it would be easier to do it then anyway.
Mm-hmm. But I have a suggestion of something to check into, but that would be
something
we could discuss.
I'll confer with Tom on it.
Yeah, it looks good.
Yeah.
And I'll
you got some ideas, Jim, sir?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or at least a question or two. Maybe three. So yeah, we can talk with Tom.
We can three of us get together something on that. Sure.
Don't the two of you get together at the same time?
Yeah, you can't do that. It'd be conflicts, whatever you call them.
And then we'll put it back on the agenda at some point when we're ready.
Sure.
So you and I will discuss at this point to see what we figure we can explore.
Yeah.
Okay, for mail, we got an email from a town resident who was worried about some water on Boyden Road that's been referred to Tom and our highway super for a further review and response. We got an email from the Franklin County Selectmen's Association meeting dates for the rest of the year. Do you guys have a copy of this?
No, I don't.
Okay. Tom, would you give Jim and Bob a copy of this so they can put their dates in the calendar?
Franklin County Select Board Association.
Yeah. Or just online.
Well, and it's
added to something.
And it's in the mail folder there. Yeah, if you're not getting mail from the Franklin County Selectmen's Association, you probably ought to be sure you're.
I may have read it.
I think we're all listed.
I think we are.
They may not have me on their new. It's my new.
That may have came in by email. On an iPhone. I just don't want to read it.
We have the a letter from the Franklin County Land Trust. They want to do a recreational bike ride. It'll be coming through the part of Conway. And they're looking for some this is just self-notification.
Yeah.
Let us know that it's coming through.
It's an annual.
Do you have a date on it?
Yeah. Yeah. It's the 20th of August. They have it around the same date every year. We also got a letter from a town resident. It's brief, so I'll read it. It's addressed to me. It says, I would like it known that I too live on a dirt road that is off of Graves Road and that I too go to work every day. I have found the condition of the dirt roads this season to have been totally satisfactory. I feel that the highway department under Mr. Sweet is doing an excellent job under what are at times very difficult circumstances. With no disparagement to Mr. Baker intended, I think the roads have never been in better shape.
Okay.
By a resident who lives over on that, off of Boyden Road. Okay, that's everything we have under mail. Do you have an announcement of any kind?
No, I'm just thinking that next week is the town caucus. In the past, sometimes we've met at 6:30 rather than 7. Now, the caucus isn't until 8 o'clock.
Right.
But if we want to meet with the Finance Committee again, I don't know whether you want to build in some extra time or not. I don't have a lot on the agenda at this point. I think it's mostly Finance Committee business. Joint budget business.
I may have to be in New York next Monday for a business meeting down at our corporate headquarters. And I'm not sure I'll be back for that.
Well, let's keep it at 7.
I may not be back.
Oh, let's have it at 7:45. That's when we can talk about the
Jim's saying he may be away too.
Yeah,
I may not be able to make that meeting next week.
So should we postpone a meeting altogether?
Yeah, that's when we can talk about the cupola.
Yeah, all right. you two can discuss it.
Well,
I'll make a motion that we don't have an official town meeting.
Next week will be a warrant, so we'll need signatures on that Tuesday morning.
Okay.
Anyway, if people can be around then, and we will ratify that at the following board meeting.
We're not going to have a quorum.
I'm not sure whether I will be there. I'm not reasonably sure I will have to go into New York.
Mm-hmm.
I'll let you know by Wednesday.
Okay. Great. You can just let me know.
Mm-hmm. Good. Anything else do we have? All right, well, tentatively scheduled, the next meeting is March 7th at 6:30, let's go 7 at Town Hall right here.
Yeah.
Before the town caucus.
Depending on if you can make it and if there's a certain amount of business, I'll see maybe the finance committee can come in at 7:15 or something like that. Just to give more of a discussion time.
Good. All right, great. All right, with no further business to come before the board and no need for an executive session tonight, I will suggest that we, I'll make a motion that we adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.